Before you can become an accurate thinker, you must understand and make allowance for the fact that the moment a man or a woman begins to assume leadership in any walk of life, the slanderers begin to circulate rumors and subtle whisperings reflecting upon his or her character. No matter how fine one's character is or what service he may be engaged in rendering to the world, he cannot escape the notice of those misguided people who delight in destroying instead of building. Lincoln's political enemies circulated the report that he lived with a colored woman. Washington's political enemies circulated a similar report concerning him. Since both Lincoln and Washington were Southern men, this report was undoubtedly regarded by those who circulated it as being at one and the same time the most fitting and degrading one they could imagine. But we do not have to go back to our first president to find evidence of this slanderous nature with which men are gifted, for they went a step further in paying their tributes to the late President Harding and circulated the report that he had Negro blood in his veins. When Woodrow Wilson came back from Paris with what he believed to be a sound plan for abolishing war and settling international disputes, all except the accurate thinker may have been led to believe by the reports of the They Say chorus that he was a combination of Nero and Judas Iscariot. The little politicians and the cheap politicians and the interest-paid politicians and the plain ignorance who did no thinking of their own all joined in one mighty chorus for the purpose of destroying the one and only man in the history of the world who offered a plan for abolishing war. The slanderers killed both Harding and Wilson, murdered them with vicious lies. They did the same to Lincoln, only in a somewhat more spectacular manner by inciting a fanatic to hasten his death with a bullet. Statesmanship and politics are not the only fields in which the accurate thinker must be on guard against the They Say chorus. The moment a man begins to make himself felt in the field of industry or business, this chorus becomes active. If a man makes a better mousetrap than his neighbor, the world will make a beaten path to his door, no doubt about that. And in the gang that will trail along will be those who come not to commend but to condemn and to destroy his reputation. The late John H. Patterson, president of the National Cash Register Company, is a notable example of what may happen to a man who builds a better cash register than that of his neighbor. Yet in the mind of the accurate thinker, there is not one scintilla of evidence to support the vicious reports that Mr. Patterson's competitors circulated about him. As for Wilson and Harding, we may only judge how posterity will view them by observing how it has immortalized the names of Lincoln and Washington. Truth alone endures. All else must pass on with time. The object of these references is not to eulogize those who stand in no particular need of eulogy, but it is to direct your attention to the fact that They Say evidence is always subject to the closest scrutiny, and all the more so when it is of a negative or destructive nature. No harm can come from accepting, as fact, hearsay evidence that is constructive, but its opposite, if accepted at all, should be subjected to the closest inspection possible under the available means of applying the law of evidence. The great Edison failed 10,000 times before he made the incandescent electric light work. Do not become discouraged and quit if you fail once or twice before making your plans work. You are well on the road toward success if you have such a keen conception of life that you never build a plan which contemplates your requesting another person to do that which does not bring that person some corresponding advantage in return for compliance with your request. As an accurate thinker, it is both your privilege and your duty to avail yourself of facts, even though you must go out of your way to get them. If you permit yourself to be swayed to and fro by all manner of information that comes to your attention, you will never become an accurate thinker, and if you do not think accurately, you cannot be sure of attaining the object of your definite chief aim in life. Many a man has gone down to defeat because, due to his prejudice and hatred, he underestimated the virtues of his enemies or competitors. The eyes of the accurate thinker see facts, not the delusions of prejudice, hate, and envy. An accurate thinker must be something of a good sportsman, in that he is fair enough, with himself at least, to look for virtues as well as faults in other people. For it is not without reason to suppose that all men have some of each of these qualities. I do not believe that I can afford to deceive others. I know I cannot afford to deceive myself. This must be the motto of the accurate thinker. With the supposition that these hints are sufficient to impress upon your mind the importance of searching for facts until you are reasonably sure that you have found them, we will take up the question of organizing, classifying, and using these facts. Look once more in the circle of your own acquaintances and find a person who appears to accomplish more with less effort than do any of his associates. Study this man and you observe that he is a strategist and that he has learned how to arrange facts so that he brings to his aid the law of increasing returns which we described in a previous lesson. The man who knows that he is working with facts goes at his task with a feeling of self-confidence which enables him to refrain from temporizing, hesitating, or waiting to make sure of his ground. He knows in advance what the outcome of his efforts will be. Therefore, he moves more rapidly and accomplishes more than does the man who must feel his way because he is not sure that he is working with facts. The man who has learned of the advantages of searching for facts as the foundation of his thinking has gone a very long way toward the development of accurate thinking. But the man who has learned how to separate facts into the important and the unimportant has gone still further. The latter may be compared to the man who uses a trip hammer and thereby accomplishes at one blow more than the former, who uses a tack hammer, can accomplish with 10,000 blows. Let us analyze briefly a few men who have made it their business to deal with the important or relevant facts pertaining to their life work. If it were not for the fact that this course is being adapted to the practical needs of men and women of the present workaday world, we would go back to the great men of the past. Plato, Aristotle, Epictetus, Socrates, Solomon, Moses, and Christ, and direct attention to their habit of dealing with facts. However, we can find examples nearer our own generation that will serve our purpose to better advantage at this particular point. Inasmuch as this is an age in which money is looked upon as being the most concrete proof of success, let us study a man who has accumulated almost as much of it as has any other man in the history of the world, John D. Rockefeller. Mr. Rockefeller has one quality that stands out like a shining star above all of his other qualities. It is his habit of dealing only with the relevant facts pertaining to his life work. As a very young man, and a very poor young man at that, Mr. Rockefeller adopted as his definite chief aim the accumulation of great wealth. It is not my purpose, nor is it of any particular advantage, to enter into Mr. Rockefeller's method of accumulating his fortune, other than to observe that his most pronounced quality was that of insisting on facts as the basis of his business philosophy. Some there are who say that Mr. Rockefeller was not always fair with his competitors. That may or may not be true. As accurate thinkers, we will leave the point undisturbed. But no one, not even his competitors, ever accused Mr. Rockefeller of forming snap judgments or of underestimating the strength of his competitors. He not only recognized facts that affected his business wherever and whenever he found them, but he made it his business to search for them until he was sure he had found them. Thomas A. Edison is another example of a man who has attained to greatness through the organization, classification, and use of relevant facts. Mr. Edison works with natural laws as his chief aids. Therefore, he must be sure of his facts before he can harness those laws. Every time you press a button and switch on an electric light, remember that it was Mr. Edison's capacity for organizing relevant facts which made this possible. Every time you hear a phonograph, remember that Mr. Edison is the man who made it a reality through his persistent habit of dealing with relevant facts. Every time you see a moving picture, remember that it was born of Mr. Edison's habit of dealing with important and relevant facts. In the field of science, relevant facts are the tools with which men and women work. Mere information or hearsay evidence is of no value to Mr. Edison, yet he might have wasted his life working with it as millions of other people are doing. Hearsay evidence could never have produced the incandescent electric light, the phonograph, or the moving picture. And if it had, the phenomenon would have been an accident. In this lesson, we are trying to prepare the student to avoid accidents. The question now arises as to what constitutes an important and relevant fact. The answer depends entirely upon what constitutes your definite chief aim in life. For an important and relevant fact is any fact which you can use, without interfering with the rights of others, in the attainment of that purpose. All other facts, as far as you are concerned, are superfluous and of minor importance at most. However, you can work just as hard in organizing, classifying, and using unimportant and irrelevant facts as you can in dealing with their opposites, but you will not accomplish as much. Up to this point, we have been discussing only one factor of accurate thought, that which is based upon deductive reasoning. Perhaps this is the point at which some of the students of this course will have to think along lines with which they are not familiar. For we come now to the discussion of thought, which does much more than gather, organize, and combine facts. Let us call this creative thought. That you may understand why it is called creative thought, it is necessary, briefly, to study the process of evolution through which the thinking man has been created. Thinking man has been a long time on the road of evolution, and he has traveled a very long way. In the words of Judge T. Troward, in Bible Mystery and Bible Meaning, perfected man is the apex of the evolutionary pyramid, and this by a necessary sequence. Let us trace thinking man through the five evolutionary steps through which we believe he has traveled, beginning with the very lowest, namely, 1. The mineral period. Here we find life in its lowest form, lying motionless and inert, a mass of mineral substances with no power to move. 2. Then comes the vegetable period. Here we find life in a more active form, with intelligence sufficient to gather food, grow and reproduce, but still unable to move from its fixed moorings. 3. Then comes the animal period. Here we find life in a still higher and more intelligent form, with ability to move from place to place. 4. Then comes the human or thinking man period, where we find life in its highest known form, the highest because man can think, and because thought is the highest known form of organized energy. In the realm of thought, man knows no limitations. He can send his thoughts to the stars with the quickness of a flash of lightning. He can gather facts and assemble them in new and varying combinations. He can create hypotheses and translate them into physical reality through thought. He can reason both inductively and deductively. 5. Then comes the spiritual period. On this plane, the lower forms of life, described in the previously mentioned four periods, converge and become infinitude in nature. At this point, thinking man has unfolded, expanded, and grown until he has projected his thinking ability into infinite intelligence. As yet, thinking man is but an infant in this fifth period, for he has not learned how to appropriate to his own use this infinite intelligence called spirit. Moreover, with a few rare exceptions, man has not yet recognized thought as the connecting link which gives him access to the power of infinite intelligence. These exceptions have been such men as Moses, Solomon, Christ, Plato, Aristotle, Socrates, Confucius, and a comparatively small number of others of their type. Since their time, we have had many who partly uncovered this great truth, yet the truth itself is as available now as it was then.